So, hello everyone. I'm going to introduce you our next speaker, and I'm really honored to introduce the Professor Hideaki Mitsuni. So after he obtained his PhD in 1995 in Tokyo, he took a research scientist position at the Institute of Physical and Chemical Science in Tokyo. And since 2011, he became an associate professor in the Department of Chemistry at the KU Leuven University in Brussels. His main research project involves the development and characterization of fluorescent protein like KD protein, and especially with photo-switchable properties, and their application in multiplexing living cell system, given their dynamic properties. And so now I give the floor to Professor Mitsuni.
Okay, thank you for the kind introduction. And good morning, everyone. Okay, first of all, I'd like to thank for inviting me for this wonderful schools. Okay, my talk is about the applications. The living, imaging in living specimens with fluorescent proteins. So the, especially I'm going to focusing on how we can use fluorescent proteins in living animals, especially the mammalian cells. So here I just show some examples. I try to continue entertain you. Yeah, there are a lot of examples here. So it's quite obvious that the fluorescent microscopy is a powerful technique to visualize molecules very specifically and also the very good contrast even in the living animals. But of course, to apply the fluorescent microscopy to the living animals is the one difficulties. How to introduce the labeled molecules inside the cells. And the fluorescent protein gave a big innovation for this point. So here gives some advantages of fluorescent proteins, why we are using fluorescent proteins for the living imaging. So first, the production of fluorescent molecules is in living cells. And the introduction of the molecules are non-invasive way. So these are very important point. And because of those properties, we can level, we can do the leveling under the living conditions. So typically in live cells, of course we can also apply this in a in vivo experiment. And since this is genetically encoded, so you can do the regulation of expression with the some specific promoters. So you can control the expression level, you can control the timing of expression, you can also control the region of expression, especially in the case of in vivo. This becomes very important. And we can also use the genetic approach to improve fluorophore, like change the color, change the sensitivity to the environment, and so on. We can also use the genetic approach for the advanced application. For example, you can design certain kind of sensors based on fluorescent proteins. And in those cases, especially very important to control the expression, and then you can control the subcellular localization of the gene, the expression of your gene over there. And we also have the fluorescent proteins with unique properties like photo switching and so on. And finally, we can expect it the one-by-one stoichiometry. This is actually ideal situation. In the real system, sometimes it's a bit difficult, but the, ideally it works as a one-by-one stoichiometry. So I just listed up the advantages. Of course, there are certain drawbacks. Those things I also wanted to discuss in the following part of my lecture. So here is the outline of my lecture. So I'm going to start from the general introduction to design fluorescent protein labeling, and then show the several examples of the applications. The first part is the how to observe the molecular distribution and movement, and second one is quite similar with this one, how to visualize the cellular structure like a cytoskeleton, organella, and so on. And then move on to the topic about the component of functional imaging probes. And then show the introduction of gene, how to introduce the gene and regulate the expression, and show some examples of in vivo imaging, and also move to the photoswitchable fluorescent proteins, and super resolution imaging also in vivo. Okay, I'm going to start from the first point, the general introduction. How to use fluorescent proteins? In theory, it's quite simple. You need to make the gene encoding fluorescent protein fused to your gene of interest, and you need to put certain promoter, appropriate promoter. The important point is to use the or choose an appropriate promoter for your experiment. You need to choose an appropriate fluorescent protein for your purpose. And then we are going to make a fusion proteins, but we also need to think how to fuse your fluorescent proteins to your target proteins. It can be on the N-terminus, can be C-terminus, can be inserted inside of your target proteins. The designing of this is also very crucial for the successful imaging. Once you get this component, the next step is to introduce this one into your specimen. And how to introduce this? This is also the next question. If you successfully introduce the gene, the next question is about the expression level. This expression level is also crucial for your successful imaging. And then once you get the expression in the appropriate range, we still need to consider these three things. The first is that the labeling protein conserves its function or not. And then are there any competition with the endogenous protein? And last point is, are there any impact to cellular functions? So we need to carefully evaluate those points. So the possible problem by making the fusion protein is mainly based on the size of fluorescent proteins. This is of course protein, so the size is relatively large. In a typical example is GFP. In this case, the molecular weight is 27 kilodalton. So you are going to put a 27 kilodalton protein to your target proteins. So you can easily imagine that there might be a problem of steric hindrance. And then if the steric hindrance is there, there's a possibility of improper folding of either target proteins or your fluorescent proteins. If the fluorescent proteins shows improper folding, you might lose fluorescence or can be very weak fluorescence. It's of course not successful. And in the case that the improper folding happens for your target proteins, that's also a big problem. You are observing fluorescence, but it's not your target, the proper target proteins. So we need to be careful about whether the proteins shows a good folding or not. And here I showed some examples of crystal structures of GFP fusion proteins. You can easily imagine that it's quite big like this, and especially in the case that your target protein is small, the size of fluorescent proteins are quite obvious. Even if the target is quite big, still there are certain impact over there. So I discussed about the improper folding, but the problem is not just the folding. Even if both of them shows a good folding, still they might have a problem because of this structure. if the your target protein requires the interaction with some other proteins, the interaction interface might be masked due to the interaction with fluorescent proteins. Or in some cases, this fusion might interfere the conformational change of your target protein, which might be crucial for the activity of your proteins. So we also need to think about the influence to functionality of target molecules. And how we are going to put the fluorescent proteins? We need to think about the position of fluorescent proteins. So the properties of target proteins should be taken into account. So the first 3 points we already discussed in the previous slides. So the labeling of N-terminus or C-terminus might interfere with their function, or some proteins might not fold properly due to the steric hindrance. In that case, we cannot fuse your fluorescent proteins to your target proteins at N-terminus or C-terminus. Or some sequence should be at the N-terminus or C-terminus. There are some examples. For example, the ministeriation signals, mitochondrial target signals, should be at the N-terminus of your target protein. So in this case, you cannot put your fluorescent proteins at the N-terminus of your target proteins. So this is just to remind you why this is important to put on N-terminus. This is in the case of the mitochondrial targeting. And in this case, the signal sequence is recognized with certain receptors, and then after the unfolding, it gets into the mitochondrial first inner membrane, and then go to between the inner membrane and outer membrane and the inner membrane, and then go into the mitochondrial matrix. If you mask something before the signal sequence, you cannot get the proper translocation into the mitochondria in this case. Some membrane ER or secretory proteins have signal sequence at their N-terminus. In the case of the targeting to the ER membrane, actually it's not necessary on the N-terminus for in general, but the sum of the proteins has this sequence at the N-terminus. And this is one example again. So here you see the signal sequence over there. And then by recognizing this sequence, it can be either passing through the ER membrane or just stay on the plasm ER membrane. But in the case of this system, first, of course, if the EGFP is on the N-terminus, they might not be recognized with this system. And second, in some cases, this is cleaved out. The signal sequence is cleaved out. If you put fluorescent protein here, then your fluorescent proteins are also cleaved out from your target. Then you can see the staining of probably the ER membrane, but it's not your purpose. So you shouldn't put fluorescent protein on the N-terminus in this case. So the bottom line from this point is that you might not be possible to put fluorescent proteins on the N-terminus or C-terminus. You need to carefully design where you should put your fluorescent proteins. So position of labeling, that's quite important. Still, of course, the either N-terminus or C-terminus labeling is probably a first choice. Simply, this is easy. Of course, first you need to be carefully check whether the it fits to your purpose or not. But if it fits to your purpose, most probably the first choice can be put the fluorescent protein either N-terminus or C-terminus. And as I said, the steric hindrance can be a big problem. In this case, by putting the certain flexible linker between the fluorescent protein and your target protein might help to reduce the steric hindrance. And most of the cases, we are going to use this kind of floppy sequences. There are a lot of glycines, and we also put some serines or some small polar residues in there. Otherwise, if you just put a lot of G, then hydrophobicity might be too high. So we usually choose the combination of the glycine and small polar amino acid residues to get the floppy good spaces. And in the case that you cannot put N-terminus or C-terminus, the fluorescent protein can be inserted into the middle of protein of interest. Or the protein of interest can be inserted to the middle of fluorescent proteins. So here is the schematic drawing of those points. So this is free GFP, and the easiest possibility is to put the fluorescent protein at, in this case, N-terminus of your target protein. Or you can also put the other way around. So that means C-terminus of your target proteins. Or you can put fluorescent protein in the middle of your target protein. In this case, you can keep intact N-terminus and C-terminus of your target proteins. Or you can put your target protein in the middle of fluorescent proteins. And another interesting technique is so-called circular permutation. The circular permutation in fluorescent protein is applicable. So the things doing here is actually putting the spacer in between the original N-terminus of fluorescent protein and original C-terminus of fluorescent protein. So at the end, you can connect the original N-terminus and C-terminus. In this way, you can introduce a new N-terminus and C-terminus in a certain region of fluorescent protein. So the idea is something like this. You can split the gene encoding fluorescent proteins into two, and then put the original N-terminal, C-terminal one into the N-terminal, and the original N-terminal one into the C-terminal. C-terminal of the circular permutated fluorescent protein. So you can connect these two, the original N and C, with a flexible flexible linker over there. So in this way, you can also use for the making the fusion proteins in the similar way. And in this way, instead of just putting the fluorescent protein to your target protein, you can control the angle of linking to the fluorescent to the target proteins. So by making use of those techniques, probably you can find the optimal structures to get fluorescence and keep the conserve the original function of your target proteins. So again, so this is there are some examples of the crystal structures, but the very important point is that the activity or behavior of labeled proteins should be evaluated in advance. And but the difficulty is how to check the activity, how to evaluate the behavior. Honestly, I cannot say in a word for this point, because it really depends on your target proteins. If your proteins are, for example, kinase, you need to check the kinase activity. If some interaction is crucial for your proteins, you need to evaluate based on the interactions with partners. So the method needs to be considered individually. The most of the cases, we can apply the traditional biochemical methods. But it's quite difficult to say in a word how you can do it. And let's assume that you can successfully made fusion proteins, and then you can get fluorescence, and your target protein shows perfect activities. Still, we need to think about the expression level. The expression level should not be too high. That's a very important point. The exogenous overexpression system is often used. Of course, there are some few exceptions, but most of the cases we are going to do the ectopic expression of your target proteins. And most of the cases, the labeled proteins competes with endogenous proteins. So if labeled protein conserved activity, actually this is a preferable situation, the risk of enhancing the activities, because you are overexpressing the functional proteins, the activity is even higher than the normal level. And if your protein lost the activity, in that case, the risk of competitive inhibition. So it's also not a very nice situation to analyze the biological responses. How we can avoid those things? There is no way to completely avoid the situations, but the expression level is low, that you can minimize the effect. The expression level should be low enough so that the impact of the expression is insignificant. So it's quite obvious. If the this is enhancing the activity, but the if the expression level is very low, the impact is very small, the same for the inhibition. So ideally, of course, there is no labeled proteins. That's the physiological conditions. But in this case, you cannot observe anything. So you need to put small amount of probes, small amount of spy, you need to go there, put there. Then you can observe what's happening. We can get the information over there. But you have everybody spies, then it's not a station that you want to observe. Okay. So the expression level should be low. But expression level should be high enough. Yeah, so the lower expression level is better to minimize impact to the system, but it should be high enough to detect signals with good signal to noise ratio. This part is very obvious. And due to that, we can avoid the strong illumination for excitation, which is the excitation can be toxic for cells. It's phototoxicity. Also happens in your artificial systems, not only the nature, of course. And also it induced significant photobleaching. Then you cannot continue the experiment. Maybe you can take one snapshot, but it's not our purpose. We want to acquire the live cell imaging in a certain time period. And one more point is that we want to get enough contrast to signal from autofluorescence molecules. There are a huge number amount of autofluorescent molecules in cells, and those gives unexpected signals. So if the expression level is low, you just observe autofluorescence, so that your expression should be high enough compared to the autofluorescence. And in addition, in some cases, the labeled molecules should be dominant, because the non-labeled endogenous protein might interfere the detection. The typical example is the detection of molecular interactions. If you want to observe the molecular interaction, and then if there are a huge amount of endogenous proteins, those molecules interact with endogenous protein instead of labeled proteins. Then you cannot see the interactions. So that's actually the most difficult situations. You need to reduce the endogenous protein and then increase the labeled proteins, and then reach to more or less the same expression level as endogenous expression. And in this case, the knocking out or knocking down plus the compensation of those or the knocking in is the best solution. But of course, it takes longer time to establish the system. So in any cases, the most important point is to set the appropriate control experiment. The appropriate appropriate control experiment should be considered. Okay, let's move on to the examples. So I'm going to start from this example to observe molecular distribution and movement, and I also want to combine this with the visualized cellular structure like a cytoskeleton or organella. So it's a very straightforward. If you can level your target proteins, you can directly observe the where the molecules are inside the cells. In some examples, just a snapshot like tubulin, actin, EGF receptor, the first tools are of course cytoskeletons. So you can visualize cytoskeletons, and you know that the cytoskeletons are very dynamic. So you can also observe the dynamic structural change if you wish. This is EGF receptor. In some cases, you can see some dynamic distribution of molecules. Like this is end binding protein 3. This is it bounds to the leading edge of microtubules. So you can visualize where the leading edge of microtubules. This one is called reticulin, KDEL, so you can see the Golgi particles over there. So it's also moving. So you can simply observe where the molecules are, and also how molecules are behaving over there. That's a simple example. But by using this technique, you can also address to the biological information, like cell signaling. And this example is the visualization of protein kinase C. Just to reviewing the signal transduction, I showed the signal transduction pathway from G protein coupled receptor. So that after the activation of G protein coupled receptor, you see in this case the activation of GQ protein. And this GQ protein activate PLC, PLC crypt PIP2 into diacylglycerol and IP3. And IP3 evokes the calcium release from the ER calcium storage. And protein kinase C can be activated by the interaction with the diacylglycerol and the increase of the calcium over there. Then if you stimulate cells by one of the agonists, in the case of this example, the cell is CHOK1 cells, and this has a prenagic receptor, so you can activate with ATP, external ATP. Then you can see the activation of this pathway. And here you can see the movie. I hope it works. Okay, yes. So at the very beginning, you see the molecules are in a cytosol, and then after the stimulation, the molecules translocated to the plasma membrane. So in this way, you can analyze the signals are activated, the protein kinase C is activated. So this is just the observation of one molecules, labeled molecules, but you can already access to the cell functions. And here is another example. In this case, talking about the PLC gamma activation, but the system is the epidermal growth factor receptor. And upon the activation of the receptor, it shows the dimerization and followed by autophosphorylation of the C-terminus tails. And this C-terminus tails phosphorylation works as a docking site of downstream signals. So that means you can see the recruitment of other molecules. Those molecules are in cytosolic regions under the resting condition, and then they can recruit it to the plasma membrane. So you can see the translocation of protein phospholipase C gamma to the plasma membrane through the interaction to the receptors. And in this example, we used the turf illumination systems. So that means this signal is exclusively from the bottom membrane. And at the very beginning, the signal is very weak. But upon the stimulation with EGF, you can see the increase of fluorescence intensities. That means the molecules existing in the cytosolic region recruited to the bottom membrane. At the end, you see more molecules on the membrane. So the increase in the fluorescence intensity means the recruitment of PLC gamma to the plasma membrane. So I just showed two examples, but in this way, the translocation of molecules can decode certain kind of cell signals. Yes? Exactly. So we are observing the bottom membrane. So we need to take into account about the clearance between the glass surface and cells. It's under turf illumination. So definitely the clearance is smaller than the 100 nanometer. And then we are putting EGF from the top side of the cell. So the EGF need to penetrate through this clearance. So that's the reason at the beginning you see the very edge of the cells, and then apparently it's propagating into the center. This is because of the penetration of EGF into the center of the cell. Okay, so we can also use this technique to visualize the certain part of the cell. We already saw that you can see the cytoskeletons, or we can also use this just highlighting the certain the subcellular organella. For example, if you put the nuclear localization signal to the fluorescent protein, you see that the nuclear is highlighted. You can put, this is the same as previous one actually, the chiral reticulin and KDEL, then you can see the ER structures over there. Well, if you put the mitochondrial target signal, you see the highlighting of mitochondria. It's just one picture, but you can continue the live cell imaging if you wish. Now I just focusing on single color, but you know that we have the huge color variation of fluorescent proteins. If you combine those proteins, you can highlight the multiple regions of the cells. And this one is 6 color simultaneous staining. So the plasma membrane, ER, Golgi, mitochondria, microtubules, and nuclear. And then at the end, you can see this kind of structures. All 6 regions inside the cells are highlighted like this. So there are huge color variations. And this is from the website shown here. And the excitation is on the x-axis, and the emission wavelength is from y-axis is for the emission spectrum. So you see that, of course, most of the cases, the longer excitation wavelength, the proteins with longer wavelengths shows the longer wavelengths of emission. So you see a kind of correlations with some exceptions shown around here. Those are so-called a large Stokes shift. That's not 100% correct photophysically, but we are often use the term large Stokes shift to explain those fluorescent proteins. So you can find the different color of fluorescent proteins. We have a big color palette now. So you see the different color over there, and this is a very famous bacterial plate with fluorescent proteins, expressing fluorescent proteins. But of course, it's quite obvious from the color, but the things we need to take into account is not only just the color. We also need to take into account about the properties of fluorescent proteins, like efficiency of maturation, the pH sensitivity, a tendency to form oligomer, photostability, a tendency to aggregate, a lot more. So not just from the color, you need to take into account their properties. So I just want to say that those are apparently just a color variation, but all proteins has their unique properties. So we need to take into account respective properties. Okay, let's move on to the next topic about the component of functional imaging probes. And my topic is not focusing on how to design the probes, and there are some other lectures based on this, focusing on this point. So I just quickly explain about the basic idea of this point. And actually already Fabian already explained yesterday a little bit about energy transfer. But let's focusing on simply the very famous combination, CFP and YFP. The energy, excitation energy, has a kind of properties of wave. So we can think about the property of wave. That means you can think about the resonance between the two molecules. This is the very famous experiment of tuning fork. If you hum, you make the sounds from here by humming, by hum this, and then you can also see the vibration of the other tuning fork. This is because of the resonance between two tuning forks. The same thing can happen for the excitation energy of fluorescent molecules. So if you excite CFP, you see the excitation of YFP through the energy transfer between these two molecules. And this depends on the distance at the sixth, this is inversely correlated to the sixth power of the distance. So the distance gives a big impact to this efficiency. And also related to the kappa squares, this is orientation factor. And this you can understand the orientation factor by comparing the molecular orbital of the, in this case, HOMO and LUMO. And then you see that the standing wave over there is switched to this kind of wave. This is in the case of the chromophore of fluorescent proteins. So light should come in this direction, so that you see the dipole moment of the excitation should be in roughly in this direction. So the if these two are in perpendicular between CFP and YFP, you don't see any energy transfer. If this is in parallel, you see the better energy transfer efficiency. So simply like this. But this one is the distance is correlated to the power of sixth, but this one is just linearly correlated, because this is the power of sixth, but here you see the 1/6. So at the end, it is linearly correlated. Also, the spectrum overlap between CFP and YFP in this case, but this one is the unique value if you choose the certain combinations. So if you are going to design the probes based on that, we need to control either the distance or the orientation factor. So it's designing of sensor. So that means you have two states. For example, in the case of calcium, calcium bounded form and calcium free form. So in these two different situations, the either the distance or the orientation factor shows the big difference. At the end, you see the difference in the energy transfer efficiency. So So you can use this energy transfer for detecting the protein-protein interactions. In this case, the before the interaction, CFP and YFP are, of course, separated. The distance between these two are very far away. You don't see the energy transfer. But once molecules interact, the distance becomes closer. You see the energy transfer. And second example, second possibility is to see the everything is protein interaction, it's not correct. This is a conformational change. And in this case, we put two fluorescent proteins on the N-terminus and C-terminus. And if you change the conformation, you might see the change in the distance between CFP and YFP, or you might see the change in the orientation factor due to also the conformational change. If you can design in the proper way, you can detect the conformational change by using the this conformation, the energy efficiency of the energy transfer. And last example is to see the activity of like a proteinase, or anyway, some cleavage, the dissociation of two molecules. And if you put the, for example, the recognition sequence by certain proteinase, at the very beginning, you see the very good energy transfer, but after the cleavage, those two molecules just swim far away, then you don't see the energy transfer anymore. So you can also detect this kind of activation of in this case, proteinases, or anyway, enzymes. And the one of the most famous indicator based on energy transfer threat is probably chameleon. At least I can say this is one of the oldest indicator. In this case, the CFP and YFP is connected with calmodulin. It's a very famous famous calcium binding protein, and M13. It's a target peptide of calmodulin. And in the case of calcium free form, it forms an open conformation. So you don't see strong energy transfer. That means if you excite CFP, you see the most of the fluorescence from CFP. But upon the calcium binding, you see the big conformational change and calmodulin graph M13. At the end, this part becomes very compact. Actually, the distance between the N-terminus of calmodulin to C-terminus M13 becomes 5 nanometer. This is actually very appropriate distance to see the energy transfer. And under this condition, you see of course, always we are exciting CFP, but you see the strong fluorescence emission from YFP. So this one is just example in HeLa cell stimulated with histamine. You see the increase in a YFP fluorescence and decrease in CFP fluorescence. By calculating the ratio, you can determine the absolute calcium concentration over there. And this is one example of the calcium imaging by using this chameleon. And this is the real-time replay of the movie. So you can see in this specific case, there are two hot spots, and then propagating calcium from those spots throughout the cells. So you can see the calcium response. So if you are going to do the long-term imaging, this is the very beginning. You can see that calcium goes up. And but if you are going to continue the imaging, you can see this kind of oscillations. So you can analyze the things happening inside the cells. This is another example by using the hippocampal neuron. In the case of the hippocampal neuron, you see the spontaneous firing of cells. So you can see the calcium response those are simply happening spontaneously. But by putting the tetrodotoxin, you can see that this activity is just goes down, and after the washing out, you can again see the same response over there. So you can use this kind of sensors to analyze the things happening inside the cells. And calcium indicator is just an example. You can use exactly the same systems to visualize a lot of biological phenomena, like pKa activation, the concentration of zinc. This is the retinic acid concentration, and this is a activation of small G proteins, and this is activation of pKa. This is the activation of caspase. Again, those are still just a small bunch of examples. So you can observe huge variation of biological phenomena by using the same techniques. And as I already explained that, you can target the fluorescent indicators into certain regions. Sorry, I just said fluorescent proteins, certain regions. You can apply same systems to target the indicators. So in this specific example, I put the mitochondrial targeting signal to this chameleon. And you see that the chameleon is really targeted to the mitochondria. This is just an example to check whether this is properly targeted or not. And in this case, comparison with the co-localization with the famous mitochondrial marker, mitotracker. So you can see the perfect matching. That means the this chameleon is targeted to the mitochondria. We can also check whether this is this targeting is perfect, no leakage or not. So we can see the fluorescent signals like this, and then this is the extracellular region. This is basal signal intensity. In the cytosolic region, you don't see the signal. That means there is no leakage in the cytosolic regions. But you see the strong signals corresponding to the mitochondria over there. So this, in this way, you can confirm that your indicator is targeted into the mitochondria in a good way or not. And then, since the calcium indicator is targeted into the mitochondria, you can see the calcium response exclusively in mitochondria. You can combine two different sensors. This one is a little bit less obvious on the screen, but the mitochondrial chameleon, this one, and nuclear chameleon is co-expressed over there. So you can see the calcium response in mitochondria and nuclear simultaneously. And you can see the calcium response, faster calcium response in the nuclear regions. And then the mitochondrial response is much slower than this one. So you can clearly analyze this kind of spatial temporal regulation of calcium response over there. Or in the case of the longer time time scale, you see the calcium oscillations in the nuclear. This is synchronized to the calcium response in the cytosolic regions. But in the case of the mitochondria, you just see the big calcium response corresponding to the fast response of the nuclear. But in during this oscillatory pattern, you don't see any significant calcium rise in the mitochondria. So just this is, again, I showed you as an example, but the, you can also analyze in a certain region of the cells, and then you can also combine those techniques to see the multiple regions. Okay, let's move on to the next point, the how to introduce the gene and how to regulate the expression. It's actually quite a difficult point. Again, I don't have the very clear answer for this, but I'll give you some idea. And then explain also some in vivo imaging. This is related to the regulation of gene expression and introduction. So the choice of promoter, this is again very important. In the case of the cultured cell, most probably you can use certain common promoters like a CMV, CAG, SV40, EF1-alpha. There are huge variations available commercially. So you can choose this kind of promoters. The expression can be too high if you just use in a normal way. But you can control the amount of DNA to be introduced. And also, the expression level can be varied cell by cells and cells. We are doing the We are going to do the imaging. So we can easily find the cells with an appropriate expressions. The fluorescence intensity should linearly correlate to the expression level. So at the very beginning, you might find some fluorescence, some cells with a certain fluorescence intensity. But if you keep the fluorescence intensity more or less same, actually you are choosing more or less same expression level of cells. You should be you should find some the fair way to find cells. If you are going to choose the very strange cells like high, too high expression, too low expression, you might get some strange results. So you need to find a very fair way to find the good expression level. But in some cases, you might want to control the expression level. In that case, you can use some controlled expression systems. The famous one is like a tetracycline on system, TET-ON system, or tetracycline off system. Here just shows the schematic drawing how it works. But simply, this is using the certain the repressor signals, and then they are using the regulator of this repressor regions. In the case of the wild type repressor, actually it works as a tetracycline off. So by putting the tetracycline, you can turning off the expression. Well, in the case of the mutant one, it works in the opposite way. If you put this one, the you can cancel the repressing activities. Then you can see the expression. So you can use this kind of system to control the expression level. You can turning on and off at a certain time point you wish. The last one is also the similar systems, so-called egg Dyson system. This is from insect hormone. So basically, there is no endogenous egg Dyson receptor in a cell in mammalian cells. So you can use also this kind of systems. Or you can also use some specific expression by using appropriate endogenous promoter. If you know that which promoter is working in the real system, you can also use those kind of promoters for your expression. The last one is slightly different. In some cases, you are interested into analyzing the promoter activity itself. In that case, you can use the series of sequences, the promoter, possible promoters to be investigated. Then you can use the expression system to evaluate the systems. So in the case of the cultured cell system, it's relatively easy. Okay, sorry. But of course, in the case of the in vivo systems, the choice of the promoter becomes more important. I'll explain this part later. And how to introduce the gene into the systems. Again, in the case of the cell culture, it's quite easy. Probably you already know a lot of systems, like a chemical-based transfection, like a calcium phosphate method, the liposome-assisted systems, or the nanoparticle-assisted systems. You can use any type of the systems available. And you can also use electroporation if you wish. Or the virus-based systems, like a lentivirus system and adenovirus systems are already very well known. You can also use those systems. Or recently, the gene editing system becomes very popular, or I should say very hot topic. So you can of course use this kind of systems. And if you can establish the stable expression cell line, you can continue to use the this system. And this is, in this case, another advantage is that the expression level becomes more stable. You might want to do the experiment with acute slice from the animal or the slice culture. In this case, the it becomes a little bit more challenging. One possibility is do the electroporation, but before making the slice, like in utero injection and electroporation. It can be one possible way to prepare the slices which is expressing the gene, or the particle gun. In this case, you can first prepare the slice and then you can just make a one shot with the particles. Or a virus-based method that's similar as this one. If you can already if you already made the viruses express your target proteins, you can use virus-assisted system. Or maybe the preparation from established transgenic lines is another method to get the slices. Probably the most interesting experiment is the in vivo imaging. That's an amazing part of the application of fluorescent proteins. Again, in this case, we can still use the electroporation in utero system. Or we can also use like a DNA or messenger RNA injection into embryo. Especially this is very useful in the case of the like a zebrafish, which is actually the fertilization and the embryogenic development is already outside of the maternal body. Then the experiment becomes very easy for this kind of way. Or we can also use the virus-based method. The best way is, of course, the establishment of the transgenic organisms or the establishment of knock-in organisms. Again, we can use the gene editing system like a CRISPR or Cas9 systems. So here shows that the example of the messenger RNA injection into the zebrafish embryo. Especially in the case of zebrafish, it's quite easy. So you can see that all those embryos are injected with messenger RNA. So you see a lot of fluorescence over there. Or you can make transgenic animals. This is transgenic mouse, transgenic zebrafish, transgenic C. elegans. Just again, just small examples. If you establish the systems, you can continue using the things. One advantage of the injection is that you don't need so much time for the preparation. If you already have the gene encoding your proteins, you can just do the in vitro transcription and then you can inject that. It takes just a few days. In the case of course, establishing of the transgenic animals, probably you need minimum 3 months. So for some trials, the messenger RNA injection has a strong advantages. And if you already know which one you should prepare, probably you can prepare the transgenic animals, then you can continue experiments. So it's for a kind of easy way, but still it's quite useful. This is one day after the fertilization. So you see that the zebrafish is still developing. This is still embryonic stage. You can see that it's changing the shape. And during this period, we can do the imaging. So this is 10x of 10x objective lens, so it's not very obvious in terms of the signal, This is 40x objective lens. You see that the calcium response is happening. This is the region so-called floor plate. Actually, we still don't know why we can see this phenomena, that we don't know the mechanism. Also, we don't know the biological meaning of this response. But I can say that there are some calcium response over there. In this case, I just embedded this into the agarose. We can still observe the response in a more stable way. We can see this kind of response. So the messenger RNA injection is already very useful technique to apply the fluorescent protein into the biological, the in vivo experiment. Of course, you can, if you can prepare the transgenic, that's nicer. And in the case of this example, transgenic zebrafish expressing chameleon under the regulation of heat shock protein 8 alpha promoter. This is just a promoter, it's not a protein. So in the case of this one, the transgenic, but under the regulation of this promoter. And this promoter shows the constitutively active at early embryonic stage. So that means you can use this promoter if you want to observe, you want to get the expression in an early embryonic stage. And indeed, you can see the fluorescence even from the day zero. It's actually just after the fertilization. You can already see the fluorescence. It's in this case, actually, the messenger is coming from this is a maternal messenger expression. So it's not made in the embryo, but you can already see the fluorescence over there. You can continue day one, day two, and day four. I didn't check later on, but I can say that until the fertilization, we are sure that we can use this promoter to get the expression. So this is a unfertilized egg, and still you can see its pseudo color is in blue or green. That means low calcium concentration. We can do the in vitro fertilization by putting the sperm over there. Then you can see the calcium response over there. So upon the calcium, upon the fertilization, you can see the calcium propagation from the vegetable pole to the animal pole over there. We can observe this kind of calcium response by using this technique. And this is biologically, probably this is inducing the cortical granule exocytosis. And that means actually the small particles are released by endocytosis from the embryo itself. And then it's not obvious again here, but then you see that chorion is released from the surface of the embryo. Then the another sperm cannot reach to the embryo anymore. So this is the blockage of polyspalmy. So this is just in vitro fertilization. Then this movie is until around 10 minutes after the fertilization. And in this case, just catching the fertilized egg, it's also a bit challenging because the raising the egg from the zebrafish is from the swimming fish. So you need to trace the swimming fish, and then you need to catch the egg, and then put on a microscope. You need to adjust the focus and so on, then you need to start the imaging. And then this is my best effort. I took 7 minutes before starting the imaging. You see that already calcium is high. But later on, you see that it goes down, and then see the calcium waves. In this case, 2 times of calcium wave. And later on, at around 40 minutes post-fertilization, you see the calcium rise again. This is accompanied with the fast cleavage phenomena. So this is 40 minutes post-fertilization. As I said, you could see the calcium rise upon the first fertilization. Then you can see the calcium rise along the cleavage furrow during the entire during the entire cleavage period and also the very beginning of the blastula period. And then later on you can still see, maybe I'll show you the movie again, how I can do it. Yes. So the later on, at the beginning you see the calcium rise along the cleavage furrow, but later on you see more random calcium response. This is on the enveloping layer of the cells. Okay. And one day after the fertilization, the zebrafish start moving spontaneously like this. It's still embryo inside the chorion, but you see that the zebrafish is already start moving. It's due to the contraction of the muscles, and you know that for the muscle contraction, the calcium rise is crucial. So this is a calcium imaging. I hope you can see on the screen. So this is the observation of the embryo from the dorsal view. So we are observing around here, and this is a cross section, so observing around here. So in some cases, you see the very small response. Probably it's not obvious on the screen. You can just see the calcium response here in the slow muscles. But later, in some cases, it also shows the big movement. And in this case, we can see the calcium response on both the slow muscles and fast muscles. Is it clear? Not really. Maybe I can show, if you are interested, I can show you on my screen later. Okay. And the technique to target into the subcellular localization can also be applicable also in vivo. So we can put the mitochondrial targeting signal, and then you can make a transgenic zebrafish expressing this one. And in this case, of course, you can get the fluorescence from the entire body. But if you carefully observe those with higher magnification, it's actually the eyes, you see that the structure is not homogeneous. Looks like the spaghetti-like structures. It's typical the mitochondrial structure. Probably this is more obvious. In the case of the muscles, you see some the noodle-like structures over there, like this. And you can compare the calcium response in the mitochondria and in cytosol. Unfortunately, those are not from the same animal. We have two different transgenic lines. One is for the mitochondrial chameleon, the other is cytosolic chameleon. So that those are from the different animals, but you can see that the calcium response in both mitochondria and cytosol. But the response pattern is different. In the case of the cytosol, you see the transient increase. This is corresponding to the timing of the contraction. It's quite reasonable. Again, the calcium is the triggering of the the muscle contractions. In the case of the mitochondria, you see more sustained calcium response, and this is also quite reasonable because the calcium in mitochondria is the regulator of the Krebs cycle, TCA cycles. And then the contraction event consuming a lot of ATP, so they require the refilling of the energy. So this mitochondrial response is most probably evoking the refilling of ATP, reproduction of ATP and refilling of the energy in there. So in the case of those examples, we just used the just directly put the this promoter to the samples, to the gene encoding the indicators. But we can also use this kind of systems, the very famous system based on the Galfour UAS systems. So in this case, you can put just UAS promoter to your target proteins, and then the series of Galfour expressing systems are available. It's very famous in the Drosophila, actually. So that you have certain driver, the combination of driver and Galfour, And then there are huge the libraries of this, in the case of Drosophila, the library of this, then you can make this UAS together with protein, in our case protein, in this case the YC2.6. If you can make only this one, you don't need to make whole series of this one. If you are going to make this one, you can just get this one from a library and then just cross. Then you can get the certain lines to express in certain regions. And this is one example. So I used QC Galifor. This is from one of our collaborators. And then we made this UAS YC2.6. And QC is the promoter in specific to the neurons, also in the early embryonic stage. So you, if you're going to use these techniques, you can target the indicators into the neurons. And if you are going to use the other type of lines expressing Gal4, you can easily switch to the other pattern of the expressions. Okay, I'm going to go to the photoswitchable fluorescent proteins. Again, so my lecture is not focusing on the explanation of fluorescent proteins. I think there are certain other lectures focusing on this point. So I just quickly explain. So there are three types of photoswitchable fluorescent proteins. Actually, there are four, but the last one is the combination of these two. So there are three different types. One is so-called photoactivatable. This is based on the Corvette-type decarboxylation. And second one is photoconvertible, like green to red photoconversion of Kaede, Eos, or Dendra to Kikujiar, and so on. This one is based on the beta elimination. And last one is reversibly photoswitchable, for the based on the photochromism, like a Drompa. In this case, based on the cis transport isomerization, and then this is accompanied with the equilibrium between neutral form and anionic form. So basically, this is based on the neutral anionic form equilibrium. So this only this one is reversible. And the first one, most of the cases, it is explained as a conversion from non-fluorescent to fluorescent. But actually, this is not 100% correct. The PAGFP is the famous one, I should say the first one reported as a photoactivatable one. But already in the first paper, it's clearly mentioned that before the photoconversion, you can excite with around 400 nanometer. You see the green light. And then after the strong illumination at 400 nanometer, it switch the absorption band switch from neutral form to the anionic form. Then it shows again the fluorescence if you excite at 488. So that in the case of the photoactivatable, if you're focusing on the excitation at 488, apparently it's from non-fluorescent to fluorescent. But this one is just switching the absorption band from the around 400 to 488. And this is the famous photoconvertible fluorescent protein, like a Kaede or Kikujiar. As I said, it shows the irreversible switching from green to red due to beta elimination. So you see that the it's really blue, green. Actually, that is yellow as a visible color, but green fluorescence to red fluorescence. And then this one is irreversible. So you can see, you can actually use this one like a memory. This is the fixed, purified fixed protein on the glass surface. So if you mask in a certain structure, you can see the conversion in a certain area. You can use in cells, of course. So this is the hippocampal primary culture expressing Kaede. It's very complicated, but if you just eliminate the certain cytosolic region of the cells, then you see the conversion of the color, basically just from green to red. But if in the case of the weak illumination, the you see the combination of unconverted green and converted red. So you can actually highlight with a multicolor by using this technique. Again, we can use this one in vivo. This one is a direct application of QC promoter, the neuron-specific promoter, to Kaede, and you see the expression of Kaede only in neuronal cells. If you expand this the neural tube regions, you see a lot of neurons. And in this specific case, I tried to photoconvert this one and this one, your so-called commission neuron. Then you see, you can clearly see the projection of those commission neurons like this. So you can use photoconvertible proteins also in vivo system. And the DROMPA, this is photochromic proteins. So in this case, the switching is reversible. So you can read, write, and erase again and again in this way. And this is based on, as I said, the cis-trans photoisomerization and a neutral form and anionic equilibrium can be controlled. But one more very important point is that in the case of the bright state, the chromophore structure, the shell, beta viral shell structure is quite rigid, and then you don't see too much vibrational relaxation. So you see the major relaxation pathway is through emissive pathway. And then in the case of the dark state, actually this part becomes less stable. In this way, actually the chromophore becomes more flexible. This makes the vibrational relaxation dominant. That the reason that the DROMPA dark state becomes less fluorescence. So we can use this one in cells. So now you don't see anything because this is a dark state. Okay. And then in the this is a resting condition, and then this is after the EGF addition. So we are interested in the movement of ARC2. This is a MAP kinase. It's existing in the cytosolic regions, and then upon the activation, it should translocate to the nuclear regions. So before the stimulation, if we activate in a cytosolic region, you don't see the efficient translocation to the nuclear, but in the case after the stimulation, you see the immediate incorporation of ARC into the nuclear over there. Okay. I talked about the photoconvertible protein, photoswitchable fluorescent proteins. And then I also talk a little bit about the photoactivatable fluorescent proteins. But actually, this is LSS Morange. It's well known as LSS. The store shows large spectrum shift. So absorption maximum is 437, and emission maximum is 573. And this is due to the excited state proton transfer. So that means the beginning it's a neutral form chromophore, and then upon the excitation, it releases the proton and then emits the fluorescence from the anionic state of chromophore. So it's a very famous protein. It's not our protein, but very famous protein which shows the big energy gap between excitation and emission. And at the very beginning, we are just interested in the photophysical property of that. And to do that, we need to illuminate a very long time to the samples. And then at the beginning, sample is again apparently yellow. That means the green, the orange emissive state. After the experiment, we found that sample changed the color over there inside the cubit. It's a very peculiar phenomenon for us. And then I don't go in detail about it, but actually the absorption spectrum shift from 437 to 553. Emission stays more or less same. And then later on, we also found that this is due to the decarboxylation at the position E222. It's exactly the same mechanism as PAGFP. So although this is known as just a long stalk shift fluorescent proteins, but actually it shows the photoactivatable properties. I can say that this efficiency is very low. It's quite difficult to induce the photoconversion in real stations. But it's enough fast to apply in some systems. So the low photoconversion quantum yield, but enough for pulsatile conversion to analyze molecular dynamics. So this is the HeLa cells expressing just free LSSM orange. And then just if you illuminate this part, you can see that the propagation of the photoconverted LSSM orange first throughout the cytosolic regions. And then later on, you see the propagation into the nuclei, like this. And this is a relatively slow time scale, but by doing the line scanning system, you can do the much faster time resolution, like 50 milliseconds or something like that. And then by using this system, you can analyze how fast molecules are diffusing, and then we can analyze the diffusion coefficient. This diffusion coefficient is the reasonable value as free fluorescent proteins. So that means LSSM orange doesn't show any significant interactions with endogenous proteins. As I said, So the point is that this shows a very low efficiency for the photoconversion, and that's probably think you might feel that this is drawbacks, but actually we are recognizing this is as an advantage, because you can also observe the before the photoconversion, photoactivation. If the this is very efficient, during observation of before the photoconversion, you get the photoconversion. So it's not possible to visualize. But in the case of this system, it takes a longer time for photoconversion. So you can convert in a certain area, and then you can continuously observe what's happening. In this case, the mitochondrial targeted LSSM orange. So you can use this one to visualize the fusion of the mitochondria like this. You see now. See, that's the photoconverted proteins actually propagated to the other mitochondria. So this is the proof of mitochondrial fusions. So the big advantage of this system is that we can use the two-photon photoconversion. In the case of the single photon, the point spread function is something like this. So first, this is relatively broad along the axis. And second is that this shows a double cone shape. So that means actually the out-of-focus regions, you see more photoconversions in the area than the focus regions. But in the case of the two photon, you can clearly see the confined photoconversion compared to the single photon systems. So in this way, you can really confine the photoconversion regions. And this one is just an example in cultured cells. And it's difficult to see the advantage, but it becomes a big advantage, especially if we apply this one in vivo experiment. So you can really see the confined photoconversions. So time's up, so I'm just skip the last part. If you are interested in, we can discuss later on. So just I'll skip those all things. Okay. So in summary, the fluorescence protein labeling is a powerful method for imaging in living specimen, especially in vivo. And choice of fluorescent protein is important, not only their color, but their properties such as folding efficiency, stability, and sensitivity to the environment should be taken into account. And optimization of expression level is crucial. And various genetic engineering methods are applicable to introduce leveling proteins. And performance of leveling proteins and impact to the living cells should be evaluated in advance. The way of evaluation largely depends on the respective systems. Okay, at the end, I'll come back to this slide. So as I said, I try to entertain you. But of course, the research is not a purpose to entertain somebody. So once you successfully get these things, that means you are just coming to the start line of your journey. Okay, so then you can go to your real systems. Okay, I'd like to finish by acknowledge to my collaborators, and thank you for your attention.
So we are pretty much in a hurry for lunch. Maybe we can take one question if there is an urgent question. Yes. And then we run to lunch.
Hi. You showed a picture where you had six colors according to six fluorescent proteins. My question is, to what extent does the overlap in the emission spectrum limit you in,
okay,
in color multiplexing?
Okay, in that case, of course, the you see a lot of spectrum overlap in the emission side. So you need to do the unmixing of the detections. So they, in this case, they use the 32-channel detectors and then it gets the spectrum of the detection. And then you need to know about the respective spectrum in advance. Then by using by applying the calculation, you can split the signals into six channels. Since we have 32 channels, enough information to split four signals.
Okay, so thank you again, Hideaki, and bon appétit.